fighting games basically.
Hello, this is Abhinav.
Yes. Do I need this really?
Yeah. Okay, so I made a game called Will Fight for Food. It was a combination of RPG and fighting games and maybe even adventure games. Like it was a not confined to genre as such. So let's start. Since this is a post-mortem, I'm going to analyze the steps from the start to finish, what it took to make the game, how it was done. So let's start with assembling a team. So Will Fight for Food was a 4-member team. Me, I was the programmer and writer. There was an artist, there was a musician, and there was a tester and slash designer. So how did we do this? So it was all done via the internet. At no point of time did two team members actually meet each other in real life. I was located in Jaipur. The artist was located in Texas, US. The audio guy was also located in Texas. And the designer was located in Leeds, UK. So the this is basically, you know, the digital era as it was said before. Like at this point of time, you don't actually need to meet people and be all negotiating salaries and such, then showing them around the workplace and all that sort of stuff. So this was, now I met my designer guy via ModDB. ModDB is a very famous site for mods and all. And my artist via TechSource. TechSource is a forum for indie games. Yeah, so. And the musician I met via another site. I don't remember that one because that's the only time I went there to get the musician. So now the concepts and planning. So when the team was ready, like we were all like, yes, let's meet again. Then we started out by making these mockups. So these are three of the most presentable ones with color. Like most of them were pencil sketches and stuff. So from the start, we made a list. Like the list was supposed to be the ideal game. If we had infinite resources, infinite time, then that was the game we were going to make. Then once that happened, we decided that we did not want a development time of longer than 9 months. So then we made a second list, which was the responsibility for each and every person. What I had to do for programming, what the artist had to do, the exact number of levels, and for the music guy, the exact number of song tracks, what effects did we want. And we also had to factor in about a couple of months for testing and all that. So this was all, so we made a plan at the very beginning. Like some people work better by just, you know, impulsively doing, like, you know, they start making their own game and then whenever it's done, they release it. But what I found was that if you keep releasing, if you keep releasing a game in 8 months, every 8 months, so you get fresh feedback every time. Like if you are updating your same game, so with every patch, the number of people who give you your feedback is reduced. And the feedback you get is not fresh feedback. Like it's from people who are already familiar with the game, who know the quirks and all that. But if it's a new game, like you get lots of new fresh people to play the game. So it's easier to analyze the flaws and stuff like that. So in the concept and planning stage, we made a list entirely for each and every team. Then it went on to the design portion. So what you're seeing here is basically, it's not very visible, but it's the world map of the game. So now the game was an open world RPG, but the world itself was not going to be as big as, let's say, AAA titles like Fallout. So what we decided was that we would divide the city into small scenarios. So you have your docks, like the right hand corner is the docks and this is the town hall. So we divided it into 7 or 8, like 8 is the end game, into 8 scenarios specific. And we set a theme for each scenario, what we were going to do. And so this was all, this 8 areas also tied up because in the game's plot, there are actually eight main characters. Who? So each area could be based around the character, like both in terms of the art, in terms of the mechanics. Then it came to the programming section. So one thing I have a keen interest is in simulating conversations. Like in most games, conversations are basically rock, paper, scissors affairs. Like, or maybe like Mass Effect, where you have your, there's a global score going on and you just select what you want and the character does the rest for you. But in this, I tried a different approach where you have to do all the stuff yourself. So this is how it looks like, a typical conversation. So there are three things you have to choose: body language, opinion, and tone. So what, on my programming side, what I did was, like, there are enough programmers here, right? I'm not getting technical or anything.
Okay,
so what I did was, you take, the designer only has to specify the personality of the said character and the context in which this is, the conversation is happening. Then the game itself decides, based on the body, the three things you choose, how much this character likes your response, and or if they hate your response, and their opinion changes on that. So at key points of time, you get this conversation system in game, which, like if you want to solve a situation, we are talking to people. So at that point, you have to basically win at this conversation. Now, the critical reception for this part itself was extremely positive. Like, most of the reviewers and players liked this very much. The second part of my programming tasks was programming the fighting. So, like, early on, we decided that we did not want to go the one versus many fighting school room. Generally, in fighting games, you have two types of fighting games. One is your one versus one, like say Street Fighter, Tekken, that sort of thing. And one is the one versus many, let's say Devil May Cry, that sort of thing. So we decided early on that it's going to be one versus one. So if you actually get in a situation where you're fighting five or six people, it's going to be very difficult for you. So you'll have to reevaluate your strategy at that point. So for the fighting system, it's like, code-wise, it's not anything much different from this, but what we did was, we integrated RPG-like stats into it. Like, RPGs, like, we had four stats, basically. Your health, your attack, your defense, and your speed. Now, usually what the RPGs do is, they abstract the fighting system. Like, you will have a menu pop up here, where you can select your action and click on that, and they abstract all the stuff for you. But we decided that since the conversation was actually quite static, so this action segment would serve as a contrast to the more static sections of the game. And this is the inventory and the four stats that I mentioned before. So the inventory, the idea was not to have, the inventory is actually, you gain items by talking to people, completing quests and that sort of thing. World exploration itself does not give you inventory items except in very rare circumstances. So this was done, actually, this was the last major programming thing I did. And it was done to basically provide, like, let's say...
Is this a view inside the game or is this a level editor?
It's a view inside the game. Yeah. So, what we found out was that if you only reward the player via story segments, then what happens is, let's say the player quits the game after a couple of hours in, then when they come back and they don't remember the story. So there is a short period of time where they are like, oh no, why am I playing this game? So we needed to provide an immediate goal and an immediate indicator of, okay, how much progress have I made exactly in this game. So the inventory serves that purpose, basically. You get these items, you can look at your inventory and you can immediately figure out, okay, like these items themselves are related to the characters you find. So you can look at that and you can say, okay, I got this from this character, which means that I have done the quest. team and we serve that purpose. Now the art style, actually this was mostly decided by the artist. We decided we did not want to go the too serious noir type look. So for this, we did a series of sketches until we finalized the final art style. What we did was, like, we started out from the pencil sketches, then those concept sketches I showed you. Then slowly, after about, what I did was, we had the first level of the game. The artist did 5 iterations of it, each time incorporating feedback from me and the rest of the team and a couple of players. And then we finally decided that, okay, this is the style we want to go on. So these are 3 of the levels. Now, what you'll notice is, in each level there's an overall color theme, and then the other characters are derived from that. Like, 2 of these levels have basically large amounts of brown and yellow tones, while this third level is mostly bluish. So you have to take this into account, because if you have this sort of kaleidoscopic tune where you have every color in every level, then all levels start to feel very very similar. Like, players won't remember, like, okay, this is the district, this was the level I went to, that sort of thing. Now the music was actually perhaps the one area where we could have done better, like, we could have improved the most, because it wasn't actually done until the last month of the game. What happened was that I had hired a musician previously, and like, he was basically saying that, okay, I'm doing the music. He would give me 1 track every month, and we had a total of 18 tracks to be done. So 1 month from release, and we had only 6 tracks. And then he came up to me in Google Doc and I was like, man, I'm too busy, I have this film and all that stuff, so I can't do this. So this is actually one peril of, like, if you have this remote working thing. So, but luckily enough, I knew a couple of people who could do the music, and we got 1 guy, and he actually did all the 18 tracks plus a couple of bonus ones in just 3 weeks. So this was we dodged a bullet basically here. Otherwise, like, the game, it would definitely have been a delayed release. Now, critical reception, like, critically it was received pretty well from all the reviews we got. One caveat was that we could not get as many sites as we wanted to review the stuff. Like, the general problem is getting the big guns to review it. Like, basically you have your, like, the mass market sites like IGN, GameSpot, they won't touch this sort of thing. So those are excluded from the spot unless, like, you know, you have your marketing department and you constantly hound them. Then Rock Paper Shotgun and all were, like, you know, small mentions here and there, no big thing. So that was, like, getting an, like, Rock Paper Shotgun is, like, an example. If you're developing a game for PC, you get a good review from that, and you basically, let's say, 300% improvement in sales. Because you know this from my last game. They did a review of my last game, and I could clearly, like, you know, you monitor your stats from the store. So that one site alone gives you a 300% increase in sales. And not to mention the recurring stuff. Every time something pops up, then what people do is, like, let's say another site mentions your game, a lesser known site. So people will take your game's name, they'll Google it, Rock Paper Shotgun's review will pop up in the first couple of shows, they'll look at it and then they'll buy it. So you have to aim at a couple of, like, there are 3 or 4 trusted sites for PC gaming. RPS, then there's Edge, then there's PC Gamer. So you have to do your utmost to actually get on these type of sites. Because that is the difference between, you know, just making your money back and, like, you know, having enough to fund the rest, like, 3 more games. So that was basically it. Like, so any questions about the... I coded my own engine.
And you use C++ and OpenGL?
Yeah.
Other graphics engine?
No, C++ and OpenGL. STL for input handling.
But this is 2D, right?
Yep. Yeah, so OpenGL can do 2D. There's no problem.
Like, you want
cross platform.
No, I know, but you do cross platform only because OpenGL is definitely more sophisticated and more complex than other two D options.
No, like basically, if you want to do graphical effects, you have to choose one out of two. One is DirectX, the other is OpenGL. Unless you go with a completely managed library. Now DirectX, while it's very good, but the problem is it's Windows only. And OpenGL is actually, it's also very good. Like for me, they are both equal. Like maybe, like if somebody is on the leading edge of graphics, they can tell you, okay, this library is better at this, this library is better at this. But for 99% of the devs, there is no difference. So considering that, there is really no, like, it's a no-brainer. You have to go with OpenGL. Because OpenGL works on Mac, it works on Linux, it works on iPhone, iPad, anything. Right? DirectX confines you to Windows only. So there's no...
But you can use the slightly higher level of abstraction like SDL or SMML to break the sprites, right? Instead of using OpenGL and drawing quads.
Yeah, but the problem then is that basically you have to adopt your entire code base. Like this code base, this game was... is basically an improvement of the engine I used in my previous game, a typical RPG. So if I switch libraries midway, then all of my work on the previous game is basically squandered. You have to, if you want to, like, to use a library like SFML or Qt, SQL is software accelerated. So you cannot use it for hardware acceleration.
Oh, I mean, on the PC and on the Mac or and all platforms, when you have hardware, you can use hardware acceleration.
Yeah, but that's the version 2.0, which is still like in beta, I think.
Even the 1.3.0, I mean, sure, you get a choice. Thank you for sharing
that. No, no, no. The SDL 1.2 is the stable version currently. 1.3 and 1.3, they actually upgraded it to 2. And that is still in alpha, actually, not even beta. So I cannot afford to, you know, stake the whole game on alpha software, basically.
Okay, I'm just sharing it.
Yeah, so the actually what we did was like the entire first month of the development stage, we basically set out to what I used to do was I gave a written description to the artist. That okay, this level is this, I want it to look like this, the landmarks would be this, and I drew some very bad images in MS Paint to help. Right? So now and then the artist would make a sketch and give it back to me. And then I would say that okay, no, I think this, like this area, we can do it like this. So in the first month we actually got to know each other pretty well. So after that, if I used to tell him something, he would do a pretty accurate representation of that. And also on the other hand, sometimes you would not follow my instructions and do something better than, because like I'm a programmer, I don't know what, like I have an idea, but I'm not an expert at what looks good. So you've got to allow your artist a bit of freedom, that you cannot afford to dictate it like down to the pixel. That's simply impossible.
Which format did he give you the artist?
PNG. Like basically, there's no point in developing your own proprietary format or anything.
So you develop PNG and PSD.
Yeah, PNG and PSD. And actually, PDN, because Photoshop, there's a problem with like, I don't have Photoshop. So PDN is paint.net. So that format.
I am a little new and some little technical question. Like, how did you import PNG in the OpenGL?
No, there are importers for this. There's a library. Like, basically earlier I had stuff for importing PSD, but PSD is actually a very complicated format. There are layers and there are groups of layers and all that. So basically, there is support, but in the end I decided, okay, let's just export it to multiple layers and do it that.
So you have to use open source importers only. There is no inbuilt option in open source, because I am not able to find something.
Yeah. Then you have to write your local.
At the end of this, what do you learn? What do you not do?
The music especially. Like, like basically you need to, like I would not hire a non-trusted developers again. And next time I would, like one mistake I did was that I only started actually doing the media work in the last couple of months. That was a big mistake, because if I had started doing it from before, then sites would be like, okay, yeah, this game is coming. It would be on the back of their heads. As it was right now, it was basically a flash in the pan. So sites were, so if you knew it within 1 week of release, then you knew it and you posted a review about it. But if not, then it was, it's because it's very hard to, like, you know, go to a site and say, okay, my game was released 1 month back, but you did not review it, now please review it. So that's, so I, like, this is one area which, in which I'm lacking in media, basically. So, I would improve on that.
What would the second question, second part of the question, is that, so how did you publish it? What was the design? Did you share that? What platforms? How many units?
Yeah, so the game was available on PC and Linux, and it sold about 4.5 to 5,000 as of now. And actually, the game is hardly out for a month, so sales are still going on. This is the last month's sale data. And currently, I'm due to appear in a bundle, which would actually. And it was on Desura, it's a digital distribution platform, like Steam, basically.
How was the price of the game?
$5.
So given the problem that you had with the team, would you want to work in the, continue working in a distributed model, or would you like to work in a concentrated model? Mm-hmm. I mean, the same thing as a little bit.
No, I mean, the problem, the benefits are definitely more than the problems, for me at least. So I would just be more careful. I mean, just because you, like, you know, like you have some problems, this stuff happens. So I definitely would still prefer to work distributed, because there's more freedom.
So, okay. Are you going to continue with the patches and releases of the same game, or going to grow it, or you want to switch to a new game?
Generally, what I try to aim for is, like, after release, there are two and a half months of patches. After that, most major issues are solved, and I start moving full time to the next game. Actually, what I do is, like, it's not like completely, you know, black and white. From this date on, I'm working on this game, and from this date on, I'm working on that game. So, just before a month of release, I'm already implementing features in the engine and all that for my future titles. So, it's not black and white. Like, basically, if you enjoy programming, then you can't stop. Like a month from release, mostly it's QA work, QA and all that. So even then, I find a couple of hours time a day to implement some feature I want or something like that. So. I don't know actually. Like the total cost, as in the expenses, or like what
expenses in terms of.
Like my income tax report.
That's
what we want.
What's your profit and loss? Yeah. What was the cost of
the game in terms of
not including your cost? Some idea of payments you made, kind of like total cost.
No, so for this, what I did was there was an upfront payment, and there was also a portion of percentage of sales, royalties, for the other three members of the team. So, like, I cannot go into the specifics because, like, you know, I don't know if anyone of you works in IT or not.
So, you gave, so, like, all the team members took a portion of the sales, they did not take.
No, there was an advance as well. I had milestone based payments, but, like, I also had, like, you know, percentage of sales. Like, this works best because even after release, after all the milestones are done, they have something to, like, you know, motivate them that, okay, like, I will go to them and say, okay, we need this patch. So, like, if at that point they would stand to benefit from this, they would be like, hey, yeah, let's work on a new game, what's this, it's done. You know, So, and also having this makes me, you know, like cut back on the initial this advances. So you have to like, it's a tightrope basically. You walk it down. Like, basically, with my budget, if I were to make a 3D game, it would look very ugly.
And why did you choose a 2D game on an iOS Android platform?
There's no iOS or Android version.
No, you should have, because there is a device available with an
I don't want to. Like,
but
basically,
market,
no, basically, D-Gigney means that, like, you know, you make the game you want to make on the platforms you want to play it on.
You don't like it?
No, I mean, like, I have a Nokia Dubba phone, okay? So,
okay.
I don't use Android devices.
But you had a question that the previous, when you were getting on Sunda, that premium gamers are not having such a game that can stand in the Indian market.
No, so Indian gamers have plenty of Android phones, right? The Android games, right? Like instead of punch, you have to click like every time. Would it be like that? So, hey, that's what I'm saying, like right now, basically, like look, it's been only, it's less than 2 years since I've started making games. So right now I want to focus on the stuff I want to make. I can sell out later, no problem. But large amounts of money.
Anyone, do you have a trial version of this also? Or
yeah.
Only a free
version? Yeah, there's a demo on my site, tarotapkin.com.
So, doesn't the trial version cannibalize your sales? Like, what is, how do you prevent your trial version from cannibalizing your sales? Does it expire? Is it limited? Is it
no,
limited?
You can play it for any, like, think a trial version basically, what it does is, it only has two levels from the game. So if the people like the two levels, then they'll pay for the rest. If not, then because like you have to think about this. You are not you're not Bethesda. Like you cannot just release a game and say, okay, I'm not going to release a demo. You know me. Trust me, it will be awesome. Because you don't have the I don't have the reputation. Like so, you have to build that. Like if you have 5-6 titles which are all like supremely good, then you could get away with not releasing a demo version. And even then people will criticize you for it. Because you want to try the game before you buy it. So it helps sales for me.
So how many copies of the trial version are downloaded for these 5,000 or so copies that you sold?
About 25,000 or something. Which is actually, I think, a pretty decent conversion rate. Usually it's like 1 or 2%. So,
anything else? You are based out of Delhi?
No, Jaipur.
And your background is into engineering or gaming?
Yeah, engineering. I have a bachelor's degree in CS. How I started was, I was a programmer in multiple source mods. Like there is a multiplayer shooter called Dystopia on Steam. I was a programmer on that. So I was a programmer on about 4 or 5 source mods. So what working on those source mods helped me make contacts. So by the time I was ready to make my own game, I knew people. I knew that okay, this guy can do my art, this guy can do my music. And that sort of thing. So that's why initially working on free projects and all is important. No, I mean, like this for on the web, making it's the same as pitching to a publisher. What I did was, in MS Paint Art, I made a prototype of my game. Okay, this is how it's going to be. And then I told the artist that okay, if you are any good, then this game will look very awesome. It already plays awesome. So
but like how can you copy protect the images or they can sell the images?
No, copy protection, let me tell you this. Like you have a game idea, I have a game idea, so I don't care about your game idea. So I won't try to steal it. Because why would I steal your idea and make your game when I can make a game out of my idea? So if you're okay, if you're like, let's say EA or Bethesda, then you can hire lawyers to, copyright this sort of stuff. But at this point, your idea does not have any value attached to it. Basically, every person in this room right now, if you gave them a piece of paper, they would list 5 games they want to make. So why would they pick a game out of your list when they have their own list? So the main, the first obstacle when I started making games was making the parser for the events. Like, whatever happens in a game is an event. Somebody walks up to you, somebody tells you something. So you need a place to store it. Like, this is getting very technical, okay? So what I did was, I made a format of the event parser, what information I have to store and all that. Like, if you have a version, any version of Bitfight, you can browse it, the folder, there's an XML files, lots of XML files, which store this events. And the game is basically a parser. It parses through these events and checks that, okay, is it the right time to execute this event or is it not, that sort of thing. So this is basically the same thing that's in every RPG ever, or every game ever in fact. So that's the basic building block I started from. So once you have that, then everything else is just variables. I beat up a person, a variable changes in the code. I get an item, a variable changes. So after that, it's smooth sailing, or like, you know, comparatively it's smooth sailing.
So what is the basic control scheme? Keyboard controls, what are controls actually?
Keyboard controls are customizable. So you can have like, you ask the defaults.
Yes, because I haven't played this.
It's basically, yeah, the arrow keys plus ZXC. Yeah. And there's the space key for changing the mode and stuff. It's not very complex thing. Like, most of it happens when you're like, most of it is when you're not threatened. Like most of the time people aren't attacking you, so you have the time to think what you have to do. So it's not that hard. No, the team members know the sales. You cannot lie to your team about the sales.
So do you share any documents with them or any trust?
No, like you have a store, so you can have multiple accounts in it, right? So they can easily log into the store and see. Like you have to trust your teammates with this. Otherwise, like why would
they?
Yeah, it's on many retailers, Gamersgate, my own site, Vistra, IndieMania, IndieCity, basically every digital retailer.